In the beginning, man believed flight to be the privilege of mythological gods. The gods of Crete, of Egypt, of Assyria, and of Greece. As man's capabilities developed, so developed his power to dream of his own ability to fly. Leonardo da Vinci, whose genius stands in marked contrast to the ideas of his contemporaries. If it were not for the dreams in his fertile mind and the dreams in the minds of generations that followed, there would have been no tomorrow. Throughout history, throughout the world, the achievement of sustained, controlled, and powered flight eluded man. The dream was there, but never fulfilled. Sir George Cayley, with his revolutionary wing designs, solved the problems of lift. Steam and clockwork planes followed in 1857. Mozeski's 1884 steam plane almost succeeded. Then, in 1903, the Wright brothers flew and created fresh dreams in the minds of the young. Duwamish, Washington State, in 1975. The Red Barn, William Boeing's first factory built in 1909, is being moved downstream to be restored as the Museum of Flight. One of Boeing's first employees recalls his early days.
I'm Mike Pavone, and I was born in 1903, the same year that Arnold Wright blew at Kitty Hawk. And ever since I can remember, when I was 6 years old, I passed an airplane over here on Harbor Island, and I was fascinated by it. And a couple of years later, my dad and we went to South Tacoma to see the horse races, and we passed an airplane there that was taking up rides for people, and my dad had to jerked me out of there and then go to the horse races. And ever since then, I was really fascinated with the aircraft. And later, when I got through school, I went down to Boeing's and I hired in 1920 as an apprentice mechanic. And that was the start of my career there with aviation.
William Boeing was born in Detroit in 1881 of wealthy German parents. Educated in Switzerland and at Yale, he moved to the Pacific Northwest in 1903. Having already developed a love of fast cars and boats, the events at Kitty Hawk implanted a new challenge, the challenge of flight. But it was not until 1915, when he met Conrad Westervelt of the US Navy, that his dream would be realized, when, after buying a Martin seaplane and dismantling it, they decided they could build a better one.
Where it all began, the BMW, built in 1916, 13 years after the Wright brothers. There were two of them built. One of them was exported to New Zealand. The other one remained here in Seattle.
BMWs were shown to the US Navy, who suggested various modifications for use as a trainer. And as America entered the war, they placed an order for 50 of the craft.
Mm-hmm.
Orders for the Boeing C, as it was designated, soon waned as the war drew to a close, and Boeing had to ride out the slump using his own resources, at one stage making furniture and sea sleds. It is now 1923, and Boeing has developed a system of arc welding steel tubes to replace the timber then in use. And it was the success of this new construction method and the company's aggressive pursuit of military orders that made it, by 1927, one of the largest aircraft companies in the USA. Throughout the late 20s and 30s, William Boeing continued to develop the company. His perfectionism and ability to choose the right associates were his greatest assets. The company continued to attract orders for fighter and military training aircraft, as well as building a series of seaplanes for the US Mail Service. In 1927, Boeing outbid all competition for this lucrative service between San Francisco and Chicago. And although bankruptcy was predicted by his rivals, the Type 40 mail plane, which carried passengers as well as considerable amounts of mail, saved the day. Rushed into service in just 2 years of operation, carrying 1,300 tons of mail and 6,500 passengers. Boeing had set new standards and still made a profit. From these profits, he went on to form his own airline, Boeing Air Transport, later to be called United Airlines. There followed a series of innovations both in design and airline management. The Model 80 airliner became the first to carry a stewardess. Then, in 1930, came the Model 200 monomail. Only two were built, but the method of construction using duralium spars and sheeting was to have a far-reaching effect on the industry. It marked the death knell of the biplane airliner. Owing much to the monorail, Boeing then developed the Model 247. Which first flew in 1933. It was, however, overshadowed by its commercial rival, the Douglas DC-3. Boeings then began a series of super large aircraft, something they were to become famous for. In 1938 came the Boeing Clipper, which set new standards of passenger comfort and became the pioneer of long-haul flight. It was the experience gained building huge aircraft such as the Clipper and the darkening war clouds over Europe that encouraged Boeing to enter the field of large bomber aircraft. The 294, at the time the largest aircraft in the world, was developed from an earlier model designated the 299. Although grossly underpowered, they were to be the stepping stones to one of the most famous aircraft to see service in the Second World War. Wisdom to realize that the government specification for a multi-engined aircraft could mean four, and recommended that the company should go ahead with the design of the 299. Its ability to sustain battle damage had a lot to do with the construction techniques used initially on the monomail. The aircraft was built in separate components and could be assembled in units or by subcontractors, thus making it possible to produce large numbers of aircraft from relatively small factories. The B-17 had been born, and with America's eventual involvement in the Second World War, production began in earnest.
Well, of course, we were working three shifts a day and basically 7 days a week, which certainly contributed to the high rate. And we had lots of people, you know, and it was very noisy. But it wasn't really confusing. We had the wing line, and we had the engine shop, and, you know, we had the final assembly, and, you know, it was just very compact, and of course it grew with the rates, you know.
Many of the changes were changes dictated by experience in combat. The first of these, of course, the most obvious was the tail turret, which was installed first on the B-17E, and then the additional armament and revisions to armament were made all throughout the life of the program to add the firepower where it was needed, or to add armor plate or protection of various kinds as required by combat experience. Using hindsight, of course, you could have designed it as a B-52, but without hindsight, there aren't very many changes that appeared to be necessary that didn't get made.
B-17 was to become a familiar sight in eastern England. Nearly 13,000 were to be built, mainly by Boeing, but also with the help of subcontractors Douglas and Lockheed. Over 5,000 were lost in combat, yet it accounted for over 6,500 enemy planes, nearly half the total shot down by US aircraft. And it was a bomber, not a fighter. It is one of the ironies of war that if William Boeing's father, Wilhelm, had not chosen to emigrate to America, Boeings might well have been flying alongside Heinkels and Dorniers. In 1985, on the 50th anniversary of the B-17, some of the wartime air crews met again in Seattle.
Yeah, that was cold. Your hands would freeze. Your feet would get cold. Yeah. Got frostbitten, the old masks would leak, now ice about 2 inches thick, right along here. They once said that two gunners in here is like two guys with jackhammers in a telephone booth. We had to, we took turns, you know, we had to make sure that we were out of each other's way. We were always bumping rears. And then the cartridge is on the floor, like a roller coaster.
Too fast, 65.
B-17 in trouble out at 2 o'clock, watch it.
Got an engine on fire.
There's a tail gunner coming out.
Watch out for fighters. Keep your eye on them, Bill.
See any parachutes, Quinlan?
Parachutes open.
Light at 9 o'clock.
Eight men still in that B-17.
Come on, the rest of you guys.
Get out of there.
Come on, Bill.
So far, there's three more shoots.
Flight 11 o'clock.
Fighters, 6 o'clock.
ME-109 at 3 o'clock.
It is a sad fact of life that an invention as potentially beneficial as the aircraft should be used for the wholesale destruction of man. Jean Genet, a poet of the 40s, wrote, "Suddenly at night the bombers came in the hard reverberating bowl of the sky, destroying the factory and the tall cathedral, the dock, the warehouse, and the railway station, the rich house in the leafy avenue, and the shouldering tenements of the narrow streets, and the bodies and souls of men." I sought my son among the smoking stones where I had crouched with him clutched at my breast, until the bomb burst and the building shattered down, and the dark came and severed my son from me. I cried out with a voice harsh in my throat, "My son, I have lost my son."
You ask about being scared? Yes, we were scared. We were thankful we were coming back because we lost a few of the boys there.
B-17Fs and started going in deep penetration. We didn't have fighter escorts to go very far. We had P-47s, but they'd only go in a short ways, and then they'd have to leave us, and then the Germans would take over, and it scared us to death.
About 60, 70 miles an hour, and some guy swerves over, and you get that feeling through you that you're going to be hit. Well, that's that feeling you have for hours at a time. And after a while, it's just, you just accept it. It's like hanging. You take an angle and you're used to it.
It's
cool
because
I was able to go higher than our other bombers, for one thing. So that put the war up higher. And that was all to the good, because it got us up at least part of the way out of the flak and stuff. So the B-17, of course, was able to take, I think, more punishment than any of the rest of our bombers.
Well, I don't think that they were thinking about the strength of the airplane. They just knew that they had a weapon, and it was the only weapon that they had, and they were going to use it. And they did use it, and they used it with extreme effectiveness.
Thank you. It happened when, soon after takeoff, on the return, almost made it. It ended for Ralph, Jack, Richard, Carl, Randolph, Russell, Louis. Here in this Norfolk field, the bite of metal on this too unsolid flesh. The stone of passing interest to walkers in the summer, buffeted by the eastern winds, still warrants flowers from someone. Good as the B-17 was, the US Army had a need for a high-altitude pressurized bomber. Before the war, Boeing had developed the Stratoliner with a supercharger and a sealed fuselage. Four were even ordered by Pan American as passenger airliners. But the prototype stalled and crashed on March the 18th, 1939. As a result, new fins were fitted. And with the experience gained with the B-17, the Model 294 and the Stratoliner led, in 1942, to the B-29 bomber. With its pressurized crew compartments and its four right engines, it was capable of 315 knots and a service ceiling of 32,000 feet. It was the heaviest combat aircraft to enter service in World War II and was used mainly in the Pacific, becoming involved in various heavy raids on the Japanese mainland. August the 6th, 1945, a B-29 named Enola Gay took off from Tinian. Piloted by Colonel Paul Tibbetts, it dropped the first atomic bomb on Hiroshima. It devastated the city, killing over 75,000 people. On August the 9th, a second B-29 dropped the bomb on Nagasaki. Mara Tamiki, a Japanese poet of the 40s, who suffered radiation burns and sickness, and who later committed suicide, wrote, "In the fire, a telegraph pole. At the heart of the fire, a telegraph pole like a stamen, like a candle, blazing up like a molten red stamen. In the heart of the fire, on the other bank from the morning, one by one, fear screamed through men's eyes. At the heart of the fire, a telegraph pole, like a stamen. For flyers, the age of innocence was finally over. The dream had turned into a nightmare."